when she came up here to talk. It's like, wait a minute, we need that. Hurry up, woman. This speech I wrote for the first class that graduated from this program. So what year was that? 2009? No. But the first graduating class was 2009. And so I'm thrilled, and it seems right to me to be saying these words to you now, because they were written for this program, for this community, which, as Mary said, I value very much. So does anybody have any questions? I can't really see you anyway, so here we go. Tracy Daly, who is the friend of my youth and whom I've known since she was 8 years old, loved as a child Evie White's Charlotte's Web. For a long time, Charlotte's Web was the only book Tracy would read. She read it from the beginning all the way through to the end, again and again and again. Each time when she was done, she did the same thing. She sobbed a great and mighty sob, and then in a single fluid motion, she closed the book, turned it over, and began again. I watched her do this. I can close my eyes now and see her. I can see the room, her bedroom, the narrow, tall windows that opened onto the roof where you could step out and stand and survey the world. I can see the wide lawn and the blue lake, and beyond that, the orderly rows of orange trees stretching on into seeming infinity. I can see how the light fell in that room. I can see Tracy sitting on the floor reading and reading and reading that book. Why, I asked her recently. I don't know, she said. No, really, why? Did you think that if you kept reading it, that things would turn out differently? That Charlotte wouldn't die? No, she said, it wasn't that. What was it then? I guess it was because it was beautiful, said Tracy, and when I read it, I felt like someone was telling me the truth. She was quiet for a minute, and then she said, and I kept reading it not because I wanted it to turn out different or thought that it would turn out different, but because I knew for a fact that it wasn't going to turn out different. Charlotte was going to die. No matter how many times I read it, Charlotte was going to die, and I knew that. I knew that a terrible thing was going to happen, and I also knew that it was going to be okay somehow. I thought that I couldn't bear it, but then when I read it again, it was all so beautiful, and I found out that I could. I could bear it, you know. That was what the story told me. That was what I needed to hear, that I could bear it somehow. In an essay by Ian Frazier entitled Hungry Minds, Frazier writes about the Church of Holy Apostles in Manhattan and how it serves as a soup kitchen and also on Wednesdays in the spring as a meeting place for a writing workshop. To let the soup kitchen guests know that the workshop exists, Frazier sometimes sits at a table by the soup kitchen door with a stack of workshop flyers and a sign. I'm quoting directly now from Ian Frazier's essay. Once, a tall, thin, long-faced black man with deep-set eyes, made deeper looking by the hood of his sweatshirt, stopped at my table. As he was adjusting his clothing for outside, he looked at my sign. Writer's Workshop, he said in a tone indicating that he was not impressed by the idea. Yes, we meet every Wednesday at 12:30 in the narthex, that little room in front of the church. Would you like to join, I asked. No, he said, I ain't going to a writer's workshop. I'd done that shit before. Really? You were in a writer's workshop before? Hell yes, I was, and my teacher was a better writer than you. Oh, what writer was that? John Cheever. Apparently the guy had been in a workshop that Cheever taught at the prison in Austin back in the 70s. I had met Cheever once, and the guy and I talked about him for a while. I asked him what he had learned from the workshop with Cheever, and he said, Cheever, you understand, he was a brilliant writer. When he wrote something, he always had two things going on at a time. He told us that when you're writing, you got the surface thing you understand going on up here. He moved his left hand in a circle with his fingers spread apart as if rubbing a flat surface. And then you get that going on, now you've got to come up under it. He brought his right hand under his left as if throwing an uppercut. You come under this thing that's going on up here, you understand. That was how John Cheever said me write. I've thought about these words so often since I first read them. I've imagined this man in his hooded sweatshirt, haunted, weary, broken, defiant, standing in front of Ian Frazier and making those motions, rubbing a flat surface with one hand, polishing something, and then bringing his other hand up, his fist up, and underneath that polished thing. And I thought, yes, that's it, that's exactly right. That's what you have to do. You've got this thing going on here, and it is a patterned, lovely thing, and you polish it to make it as beautiful as you can. But at the same time, you have to come up under that beautiful thing, you have to throw an uppercut. And that uppercut is the truth. Because what makes writing, what makes any art truly matter, is not just the beautiful, patterned, polished thing. It is the beautiful thing in conjunction with the hard fist of truth, the uppercut that says, this is how things are now and ever have been and always will be. This is the way it is. People die, friends suffer, we grow up, old, apart, we fail each other. We don't fail each other. Our hearts break and mend and break and mend again and again. In a recent review of the collected works of William Maxwell, John Updike wrote that the lies of Maxwell's fiction were employed to get at the nearly unbearable hard truth. Nearly unbearable. Nearly. We can hardly bear it. But we need to bear it. To live in this world fully, bravely, truly, we must bear it. And that is what literature can help us do. We turn the book over, we begin again, we bear it. So how do we as writers do this work? How do we get at the nearly unbearable hard truth? I thought long and hard about what I want to say to you today, both what I feel I need to tell you and what I think you need to hear. I thought about what your journey means to me and what this community means to me and what words and stories mean to me. You're going to leave this program and go out into the world, and you will find what you know already to be true indeed. What matters to us here is not what matters to the population at large. There is a supreme indifference to art, to storytelling, to poetry in this culture, in spite of the fact that, in the words of the poet Carlos Williams, men die miserably every day for lack of what is found there. There is indifference. There is disdain, and there is to the plain and simple truth that it is hard to keep doing this. The work of writing is hard. It is hard to get it right, hard to push ourselves again and again and again to get it right. Plus, life gets in the way. Bills get in the way. Husbands, children, wives, parents, dogs, dishes, mail, sorrow, indifference, disbelief, despair, joy. They all get in the way. So how do we keep going? How do we continue to perform this sacred, important work? The work that lets a small girl sit in trance on the floor of a room with tall windows and a house in the middle of an orange grove, beside a lake, on a peninsula that is engulfed by two immense seas, on a planet that is fascinating, horrifying, beautiful, brutal. How do we write books that will act as the doorway, the threshold to this world? How do we tell the story that ushers somebody through the door and comforts them at the same time? How do we become brave enough to deliver again and again the uppercut? Back to Ian Frazier's essay. Back to that lost and broken man in hood and sweatshirt who took the writing workshop with Cheever in prison. At the conclusion of his talk with Frazier, the man in the sweatshirt said, John Cheever had that writer's workshop at Austin, and later he wrote a book about the prison, Falconer, and it was a number one bestseller. I ain't in that book. He got a bestseller at the workshop, and I didn't get shit. I ain't doing writer's workshops no more. There may well come a time when you say to yourself, why bother? There may well come a time when you say, I'm not getting anything. How will I continue? How will you continue? I ask this question of you, and I ask it of myself. How will we continue? There was, for me, a very hard time that began in January of 2007. It was a time when I despaired the whole of myself. The particulars of it aren't very interesting. Suffice it to say that our relationship ended dramatically and emphatically. That was it. That was all, but that was everything to him. And like I said, it was January. Bare tree branches, dark, painfully short days, the slow, grudging slide of the sun across the horizon. Winter wore itself out after a while, and spring came, and I was still filled with despair. All the greenness in the world could do nothing to dispel it. Every morning when I woke up, there was a question in my head and in my heart, and the question was this: where do I put this, and how will I go on? Life therapy. And summer arrived in all its glory, and on the first day of June, I was sitting in the lobby of a hotel in New York City, looking out at Madison Avenue, waiting to meet someone, when a magician appeared before me. He did not literally appear, of course, but he might as well have. I saw him so clearly, I understood him. He was a magician who was tired of illusions, trickery, and sleights of hand. He was a man who wanted to perform real magic. I had a notebook with me. I wrote down what I knew about the magician and what he wanted, and then I discovered that there was more. There was an elephant, there was a boy, there was a girl, there was a story. When I got back home, I began to write. I wrote through the summer and into the fall and through another winter. I went to therapy. I wrote. I went to therapy, and I wrote. And each morning when I woke up, there was that question still in my head: where will I put this, and how will I go on? After a while, I began to see that I will put it here, with the magician, with the elephant, with the boy, with the girl, and I will go on by putting it here. And once I understood that, I was able to consciously, actively rest the full weight of myself, of my broken self, on each and every word of that story. I worked to polish it. I worked to make it as beautiful as I could. And I worked, too, to deliver the uppercut. I told the truth about everything. Ray Bradbury said that living at risk, living as an artist, writing a novel, is like jumping off a cliff and building wings on the way down. But this time, in telling this story, I discovered that it can work in reverse, too. The novel was not a set of wings that I constructed as I fell. It was a ladder that I built as I climbed up. I put the full weight of myself on each rung of the ladder. I let it hold me, and I climbed. I did not think that I could bear it. And then, by telling the story, I found that I could. I could bear it. In Elizabeth McCracken's memoir about the loss of her first child, an exact replica of a figment of my imagination, McCracken says, and I'm quoting directly now, "When I was a teenager in Boston, a man on the subway handed me a card printed with tiny pictures of hands spelling out the alphabet in sign language. 'I am deaf,' said the card. 'You are supposed to give the man money in exchange.' I've had that card ever since during difficult times, mine or someone else's. Surely when tragedy has struck you dumb, you should be given a stack of cards that explains it for you. My first child was stillborn. I want people to know, but I don't want to say it out loud. People don't like to hear it, but I think that they might not mind reading it on a card. This, I'm just now thinking, is that card. This is the card. What we do as writers is the card. This is what we get if we keep going. This is what we get if we don't give up. We are gifted with a place to rest our broken hearts. And if we work hard, and if we're lucky, we can transform that pain and beauty into a card, a luminescent rectangle of light that we can then hand to someone else. And that someone else, alone in their room, on the floor by their bed, can hold the glowing rectangle and see the world more clearly by it and think to themselves, 'It's beautiful. I can't bear it, but I will bear it. I can.' I got into an argument once with that person who broke my heart, and whose heart I broke too. He insisted that stories never saved anybody, and that words are a miserable, worthless consolation prize in this world. In Bracken's memoir, she talks about receiving condolence notes after the death of her first child. "I don't know what to say," people wrote, "or words fail. But what amazed me about all the notes I got was that people did know what to say and how words didn't fail." What if words don't fail? In an essay entitled "Death of a Pig," E.B. White wrote, "He came out of the house to die. When I went down before going to bed, he lay stretched out in the yard a few feet from the door. I knelt, saw that he was dead, and left him there. His face had a mild look, expressive neither of deep peace nor of deep suffering, although I think he had suffered a good deal. I went back up to the house and cried internally, deep, hemorrhagic, in tears. I didn't wait till nearly 8 the next morning, and when I looked out the open window, the grave was already being dug, down beyond the dump, under a wild apple. I could hear the spade strike against the small rocks that blocked the way. Never sin to know for whom the grave is dug, I said to myself, it's dug for thee. And then, some years later, why put these words for our harbor publicity flyer for Charlotte's Web? I like animals, and my barn is a very pleasant place to be at all hours. One day, when I was on my way to feed the pig, I began feeling sorry for the pig because, like most pigs, he was doomed to die. This made me sad, so I started thinking of ways to save the pig's life. What saved Wilbur's life? Words. Some pig. Terrific. Humble. Words saved the pig. Words matter. Words don't fail. In 2005, the poet Sharon Olds wrote a letter to Laura Bush, refusing an invitation to the White House. In that letter, she spoke about poetry workshops she had conducted in hospitals, I'm quoting directly from the letter. When you have witnessed someone non-speaking and almost non-moving spell out with a toe on a big plastic alphabet chart, letter by letter, his new poem, you have experienced close-up the passion and essentialness of writing. When you held up a small cardboard alphabet card for a writer who is completely non-speaking and non-moving except for the eyes, and pointed first to the A, then to the B, then C, then D, until you get the first letter, the first word, the first line of the poem she has been composing in her head all week, and she lifts her eyes when the letter is touched to say yes, you will feel with fresh immediacy the human drive for creation, self-expression, accuracy, honesty, and wit, and the importance of writing, which celebrates the value of each person's unique story and song. What do I need to tell you today? And what do you need to hear? This. That there is a passion and essentialness to writing. Words matter. And also this. In an essay entitled Second Spring, Elizabeth Alexander, who was a dancer before she became a writer, says, for me, dancers best model the life of an artist. What does it mean to work with no expectation of remuneration?
Commensurate
with the work it takes. I have a hard time with that. Mary helped me last time too. Did y'all get that? You want to say it again? Remuneration. Commensurate with the work it takes. I grew up in Central Florida. The Queen of Ballerina is showered with flowers and bows to her subjects. Offstage, her feet bleed inside pink shoes that must be discarded after each performance because they are worn through. And not just the feet, the everything else hurts and is sacrificed to make art. It's not easy to do this. And it is a privilege. What do I need to tell you today and what do you need to hear? This. It's not easy. And it is a privilege. And one more thing. I need to go back again to the Church of Holy Apostles in Manhattan, back to Ian Frazier's essay, where he talks about how at the end of the writer's workshop each spring, there's a reading in the church, and that the sound of a single voice singing or reading as it rises to the vaulted beams of the church can lift you almost off the ground. I love that so much. The notion that a single voice, one voice, can lift you up and off the ground. Charlotte, said Wilbur after a while, why are you so quiet? I like to sit still, she said. I've always been rather quiet. Yes, but you seem especially so today. Do you feel all right? A little tired, perhaps, but I feel peaceful. Your success in the ring this morning was, to a small degree, my success. Your future is assured. You will live secure and safe, Wilbur. Nothing can harm you now. These autumn days will shorten and grow cold. The leaves will shake loose from the trees and fall. Christmas will come. amid the snows of winter. You will live to enjoy the beauty of the frozen world, for you mean a great deal to Zuckerman, and he will not harm you ever. Winter will pass, the days will lengthen, the ice will melt in the pasture pond. The song sparrow will return and sing, and the frogs will awake, the warm wind will blow again. All these sights and sounds and smells will be yours to enjoy over this lovely world, these precious days. What do I need to tell you today? What do you need to hear? I need to tell you and you need to hear that this is hard and it is a privilege. I need to tell you and you need to hear that words don't fail and that the sound of a single voice, singing or reading, is capable of lifting someone else up off the ground. Good work, you guys.